Okay, hi everybody. Thanks for joining us again. Just a few very quick reminders. Everyone is muted. If you're using the event app, we encourage you to check into the session. Be sure to complete the session survey. And if you are having any troubles with it, please email us at first, or I'm sorry, events@first.org so we can help you out. The session is TLP White and is being recorded. Recordings will be available within 24 hours via the app or the desktop mobile site. And with that, I'd like to introduce you to your session moderator, Serge Strauss. Serge, over to you.
Thank you, Tracy. My name is Serge Strauss. I'm the session moderator. Maybe just one thing, you may be wondering why we show ads, and that's actually to say thank you to our sponsors who help us making this event available for free to all of you. And so felt that's important to say. We really appreciate that contribution. For the session, just before we jump in, please submit your Q&As in the Q&A box, and I'll pass these on to the speakers at the end of the talk. And I guess, without further ado, I'd like to welcome Aurelien and Alexander from Circle. I do not think they need any more introduction. I'm really looking forward to their talk. Aurelien and Alexander, welcome. The screen is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Serge. Thank you, Tracy. It's a great pleasure to be here today. And nevertheless, it's usually great to go to first conference physically. I mean, even doing a remote one is great. And I think don't hesitate to eat your snacks, relax yourself, and to watch the talks. So we will talk about something that we are really fan of for the past year, and we try to do it even better for the future, and about passive collection. So I'm Alexandre Delonois, I'm one of the security researchers at Circle, and there is Aurelia, which is one of the security researchers at Circle too. So to quickly introduce what we want to talk about, it's about passive SSH, and I'm pretty sure many of you are already very familiar with passive DNS and even passive SSL. So for us, it was kind of a, I would say, logical grow into passive collection and threat intelligence for finding new fingerprints and so on. So why we came with this idea, it's I think very basic, but I think common in a lot of CSIRT. So a lot of CERT and security operations center run their own passive DNS. They have their own passive SSL database too sometimes. And it was really one of the key elements when you do incident response. I mean, if you search and pivot point, data points where you can find back additional infrastructure of attackers, finding new victims and so on, passive DNS and passive SSL was really a key element. And I think it still works and so on. It's interesting. A lot of people are using it. Even if passive DNS collection is more difficult nowadays, there's still a huge interest of it, in it, and it's still very useful when you do incident response and analysis online. But what we have seen, and that's quite interesting, is SSH is really taking over the world. I mean, if you look at all the services on the internet, VPS, cloud services, and so on, I mean, a lot of them are remotely accessible. And that's very interesting because it's giving a lot of insight. Even if SSH is an encrypted protocol, just like SSL and TLS sessions, you have some international interesting fingerprints that you can collect and use for your analysis and so on. That's really interesting because SSH is really taking over. I mean, it's not only VPS and so on, but if you look at IoT device and so on, SSH is everywhere. So that's quite interesting because on the victim side, you can really fingerprint those victims, notify them and so on, but you can also fingerprint attackers, adversaries, because they do SSH too, and then administration of their infrastructure. So that's really an interesting point. And SSH basically have a lot of fingerprints. If you look at the protocol, and we will go deeper in that during the presentations, there are many things that you can fingerprint from the banner itself, up to keys, elements, specific handshake, and so on. That's quite interesting to see the different way of fingerprinting this. And that's really what we wanted to do with passive SSH. So thing that we learned from the past, that we learned from passive DNS collection and so on, if you design a passive DNS or a passive SSL service, you need to be fast. That's the service need to be able to respond very fast. for various reasons, but one of the reasons is when you do incident response, you process a lot of data, you want to look up in the database in a quick way, so you don't want to be basically slowed down by just doing a lookup in the database. So one of our initial requirements when we designed the software was to be sure that we are able to do fast lookup based on IP addresses, fingerprint, and specific hash. And that's the interesting part. Salesforce designed some time ago a specific hashing attribute for SSH, a specific SSH uncheck. And we'll go in details on how it's calculated, but this one is very interesting because it's an easy way to fingerprint SSH connections without looking at IP addresses and so on, but really at the uncheck itself. And if you want to do some detection, some even filtering and blocking on network level, HSSH is really cool for that. And that's something that we really use. So we are really glad to reuse what Salesforce did on HSSH. And you will see in passive SSH, you can really actively use HSSH for querying up the database. Thing that we wanted to do is to have really a lightweight design. And the reason behind is the following. It's not only for internet-wide scanning that we want to do it, but passive SSH can be used internally too. A lot of organizations have their own SSH services running internally. Sometimes they get compromised, and you want to differentiate clearly what are your SSH infrastructure versus the one operated by the attackers. And one way to do it is to basically collect such kind of fingerprint. So that's what we wanted to have, these kind of things where you can basically feed the database of passive SSH with either scanner input, Zmap, name your scanner, Nessus, whatever, basically network captures and so on. And the idea really is that the system can be used either as an external system, so that means only for internet things, but also for more private one or internal infrastructure scanning, because it was sometimes something that we were really missing in incident response, where we go on site and we're starting to do analysis. We wanted to differentiate, for example, SSH server keys that are legitimate from the one that are used by the attacker as backdoor and so on. And what we wanted to do with this design is to be sure that we support IPv4 and IPv6, but not only. As we were scanning some specific services in Tor, for example, we wanted to support onion addresses too. And that was kind of important. And not depending on the default allocated port of SSH, but to be able to use different random TCP ports. So now we will go more into the design and what we design. So maybe Aurélien can go a bit further on that.
Yeah, so passive SSH server and the ingester are written in Python 3 and are released as an open source project with under NodeGPL 3 license. So feel free to try it and play with it. The database, we are using Redis server as database. So you can use any Redis compatible backend, for example, WorkDB or Caverock if you want. There is also a simple SSH scanner in the repository if you want to manually scan small network or internal infrastructure. And we will provide access to the SSH server to any first TFC cert or the CNW members.
Yeah, this one is quite important. It's basically everyone can basically run the software, and that's why we release it today. And that everyone can basically use it and run their own passive SSH database. But at Circle, we are running it at with an internet-wide scanner behind, and we make it accessible for all first members, TFC CERT, and CERT network members. So if you are one of those members, so currently we limit the access because there are some maybe sensitive information in the database, and we want that it's really something that CERT can use to notify victim or a potential user. So. We just released the software today. It's not a release 1.0, so it's still a bit beta, but it's running. So we have various instances running. It's operational, so you can really install it and so on. It's super easy to install. If you have any issues, bug report and so on, don't open an issue on GitHub, and that will be super cool. Okay, so now if we go more about the detail, and I think this one is the more interesting element, is what can you fingerprint with SSH? And if you look carefully with SSH, you can really fingerprint a lot of things. Obviously, the first thing that you, which is important to fingerprint, is the IP addresses, the hostname, the onion addresses that you are basically fingerprinting. I think this is really one key point. If you look at passive DNS or passive SSL, usually the classical thing is, I have an IP address and I want to know many certificates on this one. Or I have this certificate, this fingerprint, and I want to know which IP address is. And that's a key element. But in SSH, there's some additional information that you can really use. And this one is I think, we were a bit surprised, I would say, when we started to do scanning on SSH to look at the banner. And the banner itself on SSH is giving a lot of insight. We will show some examples later on, but that's quite interesting. This one is really an interesting pivot point for various reasons. And in the passive SSH server that we have, we are storing the banner, and you can even search a specific host per banner. I'll show some examples on that, and that's interesting. And then there is the, I think a very important element is really the relaunch check to describe the cryptographic protocols and cryptographic algorithm that your SSH client and SSH server will use. And this isn't clear. So if you scan and you get this connection, you can basically get those kind of answers. And that's where this famous hash from Salesforce is coming in. Salesforce decided to do a hash based on the key exchange, so the key exchange protocols used, the encryptions, the MAC algorithm used, or compression is enabled or not. And using that is giving a kind of a very unique hash, which is really differentiating kind of software. So for example, if you use a custom scanner or a custom DDoS, and again, SSH and so on, it will be unique. So for example, in our database backend at Circle, we look at the hash that we have for those SSH, and we see a lot of common ones. So for example, for very common distributions like Ubuntu, Debian, and so on, you always have the same hash. And it's really, really handy because you can basically cluster and group different kind of server based on their capabilities they have on SSH. And a lot of systems like IoT, routers, and so on have their own custom one. And you see in the banners, it's full of very interesting things. It's even telling operating system and so on. But just by looking at the exchange and the key exchange that they do, you can really get a lot of information about the underlying software, versions, and so on. Then one of the most important aspects too in the passive SSH aspect is for each of the scan that we do, for example, we collect all potential keys. And that's quite important too, because in SSH, when you have services running, you have usually more than two keys, or sometimes two keys, or even three or four different keys, because there are different cryptographic algorithms that are usually supported by the server. But it's giving a lot of insight, because when you connect, you can make an uncheck and get the server key, and then calculate the fingerprint. And that's all the information that you can get from from SSH, and we collect that information into the passive SSH server, and then you can start to search into the server. So that's really the overview. We have still some pending questions that we want to solve, and that's, for example, you have the language field definition, which is usually not used for hash SSH, but might be an interesting thing for fingerprinting some additional things. We don't look too much into other things, but we can use additional data points within the, for example, key exchange process to start to pivot and so on. So currently, what you can do in the passive SSH server is per fingerprint, so read key fingerprint, key type, you can look for hash SSH, and per banner, so you can really search for that, and obviously IP addresses and so on, which is like the most obvious. So currently we just look at this. We don't look at all at the encrypted packet and so on, but really in the uncheck part, it's really interesting, and this one is giving already a lot of insight. So how does it work? So we have a REST API accessible in passive SSH, and you can basically query it. It's super simple. For example, you have an endpoint which is called banners, and like the name is mentioning, it's basically getting all the banners. And it's giving you a list of all the banners that SSH server has seen with the number of occurrences. And you can see that immediately you can spot on a lot of things. That all those banners are different depending on the operating system, and they are rarely modified. We have even some interesting funky story about that, where some attacker decide to modify the banner, but they modify in a way that is so unique that you can find all the infrastructure of the attacker on the internet. So that's quite funky too, and that's giving a lot of insight about machines, are they up to date, and so on. As a CSRT, it's really useful, especially that if you want to know in your constituency if specific SSH server or distribution are vulnerable to specific things, you can have a look at just the SSH banner, and it's giving a lot of insight. For example, this one is a partial scan of the internet, so you see that you have a lot of data. So for example, there are even people modifying the banner for their own tools because they need to do so. And this one is an interesting example. So it's a banner for OVH. OVH is a well-known hosting provider, and I think many of you know OVH already. And what you can see there, it's they use their own banner for the rescue. So it's giving you a list of IP addresses running as VPS and so on their infrastructure that are in rescue mode. So it's just by looking at SSH, and you can already deduce that, so it's quite interesting, and you can even see which operating system. For example, for the FreeBSD, rescue mode is different than the default Ubuntu one, because they use different version of SSH. So it's really giving an insight by just looking at those SSH banners. Another interesting case is a lot of vendors are modifying it to be compatible with their clients, but it's giving a lot of insight, not only for you as incident responders, but it's giving a lot of insight for attackers too. For example, Lancome has their own banner for finding, for example, their equipment. But as an attacker, if you see those Lancome devices, you can basically scan them automatically in an easy way without finding all of them. So that's why we currently restrict a bit the access to the passive SSH one, because we don't know that people are running scan on over vulnerable machine and so on, but we hope that it will be useful for a lot of people to patch their systems and be sure that they are running their latest version there. So you see that just looking at SSH banner is giving already a lot of insight. Then you have classical pivot points. This example, it's clumsy on the text, but it's a lot of information. If you can pivot per IP addresses. And that's interesting there. You can see, for example, first in, last in, you can see the specific banner. So I take one of those examples with Lancome. You see the hash SSH, which is basically the hash containing the different protocol used and supported. For example, in this case, compression mode. And so on. So it's again giving a lot of insight, but this is the value that is helping to construct the HSSH. And then for this specific host, we have two keys. We have an RSA key and a DSSS key. So you see that if, for example, this IP address got more keys, you'll get all those different keys there. Maybe Aurélien, you want to add something there?
Yeah, is there also another endpoint with you just add a slash history to get the scanning history of on a phone host?
Yeah, and that's interesting too, because it's what passive SSL was doing too. You can find IP addresses that are fixed or IP addresses that are dynamic and see their following based on their fingerprint. Because, for example, if you have a private DSL connection with dynamic IP addresses, and they are opening an SSH port for doing remote management, for example, even if the IP address is changing, you can really follow the SSH key materials because they remain the same. A side note regarding keys in SSH, they tend to be very fixed. Nowadays with TLS, for example, with Let's Encrypt, usually they are renewed every 90 days. So you have a lot of fingerprint, it's difficult to trace. But on SSH, it's very different. It's very rare when people are renewing their keys on a server. So that means you have a very long-lasting time of those keys on the infrastructure. So it's applicable for victims, but for attacker infrastructure too. They tend to reuse the same key on a very long period of time. And if you have an interesting key that you want to have a look at, you can basically get on the endpoint, fingerprint all, you can put one of those fingerprints and get the full key encoded in base64 for further analysis. while we are doing and keeping the keys, we have seen that some IoT equipment, for example, are generating weak keys. We have seen that with TLS, for example. We have a project called Snake Oil Crypto, where we collect those keys, find, for example, for common denominator on those keys, and those one can be easily factorized. Same with SSH, it applies too. So what we want to do is to have a full run on the existing one and to be able to notify potential victims of weak key materials in their equipment. And especially that we have some, for example, nowadays we have elliptic curve keys, and those ones might be sometimes with wrong setup. We have seen that previously in TLS, but sometimes even in SSH, I think it's even more predominant due to the equipment that are sometimes exposing SSH, which is like low-level equipment with poor random sources and stuff like that. So, and you see again, when you search for a specific fingerprint, you get back the host and the number of IP addresses. For this specific key, you have only a single host, but you can really find different hosts, for example, having the same fingerprint. So what can you do with that? So just today, we will take two examples that really help us there with the passive SSH. One is really monitoring the attacker infrastructure. So it's something to keep really in mind. Attackers are also system administrators and so on. So it's very important that those one are operating SSH. So you can really track down attackers on those different IP addresses by just looking at their fingerprint. And, so on. And again, those keys tend to be renewed less often. And then you can find back those attackers on a quick way. Just for the side note, if you want to read on attribution, especially monitoring attacker infrastructures, Timo Stephens did a very interesting book about attribution in advanced persistent threat. And this is specific chapter 4, where it's focusing on the attacker infrastructures. And there's some example with passive SSL, but those examples could be even extended with passive SSH nowadays. And it's really giving an insight about the attacker infrastructure. A second one, and this one is, I would say, a bit funky, but it works pretty well. We did the test recently. So you have the internet-wide scans with all IP addresses on the internet, and at the same time, you scan onion addresses on Tor that you know about having SSH access. So it's a very low percentage. But the thing is, if you find a fingerprint on a real IP address and the same fingerprint on a Tor onion, you can basically uncloak the Tor hidden servicing behind. So we did the test, and around 1.5% of Tor onion services are running SSH, and we were able to uncloak some, for example, forums and so on that were on the internet and at the same time on Tor, or reusing the same SSH key for another services, which is for Tor operators one of the best things to do, but sometimes it's useful for security and incident response. So it's just two examples. We are running short of time, but we have plenty of interesting examples. So if you later on have some questions, we can even talk about those ones later. So what's next and what do we plan to do there? It's to have a MISP module. So for the one using MISP, is to have a full-blown integration with SSH expansions. So you can really use SSH as a pivot point into your trade intel platforms. Thing that we want to do is to have the same model of correlations in a Hale framework, where we can do correlation on Tor hidden services and other services using SSH. We need to provide in the repository a PCAP feeder. So if you have a passive collections from PCAP due to incident response and so on, you can feed into the passive SSH. One of our colleagues is working on the review of cryptographic material. So if you're curious how it works, it's called Snake Oil Crypto. So we did that for TLS. We already notified a lot of victims about weak key materials and so on, but we want to do exactly the same for SSH. And to have a final release of the software foreseen in the next week, but at least we have like a first really stable version. So if you have some bugs, report and so on, feel free to tell us, and we will be glad to basically support you there. So if you don't hesitate to get in touch with us, we have email at Circle, so if you want to get access to the passive SSH database, if you want to install the code, have a look at it and so on, you can go on the GitHub page. And we have a specific Twitter page for this project, which is called D4 Project, where the passive SSH is and passive DNS and so on. It's an European funded project there. At Circle, we basically collaborate and create this project to support incident response on network collections, analysis, and so on. So that's it for us today. So if you have any questions and so on, feel free. That's the time. Thank you.
Yeah.
So thanks a lot for the really interesting talk. This is kind of not a day without learning something new in InfoSec. So that was actually quite interesting. There's a couple of questions. Sylvan Martinez asks, when you install and use your passive SSH tool, is this just a local environment or is it connected to your backend database? You mentioned you can get access to your backend. Not sure about how the data flow, what is shared.
Okay, that's a very, very good point. So Sylvan, thank you for the questions. It's indeed completely autonomous. So the code that if you pull the code on the GitHub repository, it does not connect to our backend. So you basically run your own passive SSH and so on, and you do it on your own, and you don't need internet access. If you want to run it internally for private usage, you don't need internet access and so on. The thing that we provide is basically exactly the same software that we provide on GitHub at Circle, where people can do a lookup and do answer about the SSH activities, but it's completely disconnected. So we don't, it's fully local. We don't share any information. The only thing that we share at some point is one of our sys instance running at Circle premises and where we did the scan for SSH. So you can really run the tool set without having any need of connection to third parties.
Okay, and then another question from Sylvan, is there a potential use case where you could apply the same technique on network traffic syncing of IDS systems?
Yeah, that's a good point too. For example, we could extend it to active one. So that means, for example, you can do the collections in a stream way. So the ingester is very flexible. So what you could do, for example, is to have a Zeek, Suricata, or specific Moloch tools that are extracting the data for you. And you can feed it into the systems to have the database for the passive SSH. So that's obviously that can work. And to be honest, to create such script, if you have already all the data coming in from a stream, it's a matter of 1 or 2 hours. So if you're interested, just don't hesitate to open an issue and we will even create it. If you have a sample JSON file, we can even do it.
Okay, cool. Thanks a lot. Then another question from Marne Ginsberg. Great idea. I'm curious though why you call it passive SSH when you collect the data in an active scans.
Yeah. So when we talk, and that's exactly the same discussion that we have with the passive SSL, we talk it passive when we talk about querying the database. The collection mechanism are separated parts. I was mentioning both during the talk for the reason of having the complete workflow, but usually we talk about passive because it's a passive lookup against the database. So that means we don't do active connection to SSH, but indeed you need a source. And that's exactly the same with passive DNS. I mean, at some point, you need to collect the data, but when you do the query, you don't query back the DNS. Okay, except for Bailiwick and so on, but that's another story. But that's the thing is, it's basically passive when you do the lookup. On the other end, you still need to do the collection, and indeed, then you need to scan. But this collection can be active or passive then. That's it's up to you to decide.
Okay. Then thanks a lot. There's no more questions. Sylvain says thanks. And
thank you very much. That's great.
And this was a great talk. It's kind of a pity we can't keep chatting on over coffee, but I guess life's tough.
Yeah, next time.
To all the participants. And
thank you very much. That's
you
great.
Guys, for your really outstanding work in general. Much
thank
appreciated.
You.
Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.